This is Studio One at CBS. The Columbia Broadcasting System invites you to Studio One for the 12th in a feature series of hour-length versions for listening of celebrated stories, novels, and plays. We introduce the director of Studio One, Fletcher Markle.
Our story tonight is one of the very great American family portraits by a man who is almost without challenge America's greatest dramatist. Our Wilderness by Eugene O'Neill. All of you will have memories of the 4th of July just behind us, and many of you have memories of a 4th of 40 years ago. But whatever your age or the length of your recollection, the members of the Miller family in Mr. O'Neill's Our Wilderness will be familiar to you. We're all acquainted with a father like Nat Miller and a mother like Essie and the Mildreds and Arthurs of their family and relatives like Aunt Lily and Uncle Sid, even if we're not precisely aware of what happened to them on July the 4th, 1906, in the Connecticut town where they lived. And most certainly, we're all acquainted with someone like Richard Miller, who is going on 17 just out of high school. Topping the list of our players on Studio One tonight is the name Don Harron. To be cute, we might call him Master Don Harron, but to be fair and accurate, we must call him Mister. In his earliest 20s, a young Canadian actor of beguiling talents making his first appearance on the American air herewith, we introduce Mr. Harron as our Richard tonight. You'll be hearing Everett Sloan as his father, joining an impressive list of fathers that includes George M. Cohan, Will Rogers, Lionel Barrymore, and Walter Houston. Catherine Rott will be Richard's mother, with Anne Burr as Belle and Ruth Gilbert as Muriel, the role Miss Gilbert created in the original Broadway production. Turn back the calendar 40 Julys ago, and please to begin.
From Studio One, CBS presents Our Wilderness by Eugene O'Neill, as arranged for radio by Fletcher Markle.
All right, now everybody, come along into the sitting room. Well, we've all had a good breakfast. Now let's take a few minutes and sit down and have a good look at each other. It's the 4th of July and a lovely day. It isn't often we all get a chance to be together. Essie, my dear, you sit there by the table where you always sit.
All right, Nat.
Now, Arthur, you pull up a chair for your Aunt Lily.
Yes, Pa.
And then you and Mildred sit on the sofa with your Uncle Sid. Oh, where's Tommy?
Outside, Pa.
Oh, yes, that's right. He shot out from the breakfast table to get his fireworks ready. Well, as for me, I'll take my old rocker. There we are. Now then, what's on the tappy for all of you today? Oh, Sid, you're coming out to the Sachem Club picnic with me, of course.
You bet. I mean, I'd like to, Nat. That is...
I know what that Sachem Club picnic's always meant.
No, not this time, Essie. Sid's a reformed character since he's moved over to Waterbury to be on the paper. At least that's what he swore to me last night.
Why, sure, Lily. They might even run me for president of the WCTU.
Now, look, Sid, we're going to have dinner in the evening tonight, and I don't want you coming home, well, not able to taste it.
Oh, I know he'll be careful today, won't you, Sid?
Lily, I swear to you, if any man offers me a drink, I'll kill him.
That is, if he changes his mind.
Oh, no use talking to him, Lily. You ought to know better by this time.
Now, you women, stop picking on Sid. Even a downtrodden newspaper man has a right to enjoy himself when he's on his holiday.
That's right. And we haven't heard a word from the children yet. How are you spending the festive 4th, Arthur?
I can tell you, Uncle Sid, if he won't.
Mildred!
Don't shout at your sister now, Arthur. You're off to the Rands, I suppose.
I and Bert Turner are taking Elsie and Ethel Rand canoeing. We're going to have a picnic lunch on Strawberry Island. And this evening, I'm staying at the Rands for dinner.
Ah, you're accounted for then, son. How about you, Mid?
I'm going to the beach to Ann Culver's.
Of course, there won't be any boys present.
Oh, now, stop your everlasting teasing, you two. How about you and Lily, Essie? What do you say to an automobile ride? I'll get out the Buick and we'll drive around town, out to the lighthouse and back.
And then Sid and I will let you off here, or anywhere you say, and we'll go on to the picnic.
I'd love it, wouldn't you, Lily?
It would be nice, yes.
Well, then that's all settled. Lily, want to come with me to the fireworks display at the beach tonight?
Well,
That's right, Sid, you take her out. Poor Lily never has any fun, always sitting home with me.
I'd like to, Sid, thank you. Only not if you come home from the picnic. You know.
Listen, Uncle Sid, don't let me catch you and Aunt Lily spooning on the beach tonight, or it'll be my duty to call a cop.
That'll do you, Arthur. Your education in kicking a football around Yale seems to have blunted your sense of humor.
Say, where's Richard? I thought he came in with us from breakfast.
I'll bet he's off somewhere writing a poem to Muriel McComber, this silly. Or pretending to write when I think he just copied.
He went out on the side porch, I think, to read a book. He's always reading now.
That reminds me, Nat. I've been meaning to speak to you about those awful books Richard is reading.
Awful books?
You've got to give him a good talking to. I'll go up and get him right now. I found him where he'd hid him on the shelf of his wardrobe. You just wait till you see him.
Seems to me she might wait until the fourth is over.
Yeah.
Oh, there's nothing to it anyway. Sid, when I think of the books I used to sneak off and read when I was a kid...
Me too. I suppose Dick is deep in Nick Carter, old Cap Collier.
No, he passed that period long ago. Poetry is his red meat nowadays, I think. Love poetry. And socialism, too, I suspect, from some dire declarations he's made. Well, might as well get him on the carpet. Where'd you say he was, Arthur?
Out on the side porch, Father, I think.
Richard? Richard?
All right, I'm coming.
Did you want me, Pa?
I'd hoped I'd made that plain. Come and sit down a while.
I didn't hear you, Pa. I was off in another world.
You sure were.
Yeah, that's enough now. Oh, Dick, what are you planning to do with yourself today? Going out to the beach with Mildred?
That silly skirt party, I should say not.
He's not coming because Muriel McComber isn't. But he's got a date with her somewhere.
You shut up, Mid. I thought I'd just stay home, Pa, this morning anyway.
Help little Tommy set off firecrackers, hmm?
I should say not. I don't believe in this silly celebrating the 4th of July. All this talk about liberty when there is no liberty. Land of the free and the home of the brave. Home of the slave is what they ought to call it. The wage slave, ground under the heel of the capitalist class. Starving, crying for bread for his children. And all he gets is a stone. The 4th of July is a stupid farce.
Them are mighty strong words, Richard. Better not repeat such sentiments outside the bosom of the family, or they'll have you in jail.
And throw away the key.
You too, Brutus, Uncle Sid? Then let them put me in jail. But how about the freedom of speech in the Constitution, then? That must be a farce, too.
You know, son, if I didn't know it was you talking, I'd think we had Emma Goldman with us.
Never mind, Pa. Wait till we get him down to Yale. We'll take that out of him.
Oh, Yale. You think there's nothing in the world besides Yale?
Don't let him scare you, Dick. Give it to him.
Sid, you stay out of it now.
Oh, hello, Aunt Lily. I didn't see you.
Well, Richard, I've always found I've had to listen to at least one stump speech every fourth. I only hope getting your extra strong one right after breakfast will let me off for the rest of the day.
That's right, lad. After you, the deluge, you think. But look out. Supposing it comes before. This isn't the Dark Ages. This is 1906. The days grow hot, O Babylon. 'Tis cool beneath thy willow trees.
Oh, that's good. Something from that book you've got with you there?
No, Pa. This is Carlyle's French Revolution.
Well, I'm glad you're reading that, Richard. It's a darn fine book.
What, have you read it, Pa?
Well, you see, even a newspaper owner can't get out of reading a book every now and again.
Young man, you tell me this minute where you've hidden those books. They've been moved.
Oh, Ma.
Just what books are they, Richard?
Well, there's...
There were two by that awful Oscar Wilde. One was called The Picture of Something or Other. The second was poetry, The Ballad of... Oh, I forget what.
The Ballad of Reading Gold, one of the greatest poems ever written.
And then there were two books by that Bernard Shaw.
The greatest playwright alive today.
One had a long title I couldn't make head or tail of, only it wasn't a play.
The Quintessence of Ibsenism.
Golly, what does it mean, Dick?
I'll bet he doesn't know.
I do, too, know. It's about Ibsen, the greatest playwright since Shakespeare.
Yes, there was a book of plays by that Ibsen there, too. And poems by Swin-something.
Poems and ballads by Swinburne, Ma. The greatest poet since Shelley. He tells the truth about real love.
I'm next on that one, Dick. I feel the need of a little poetical education.
And then there was Kipling. But I suppose he's not so bad. And last, there was a poem. A long one. The Ruby... What is it, Richard?
The Rubaiyat of Omar Khayyam. That's the best of all.
Oh, I've read that, Essie. I got a copy down at the office.
So have I. It's a pippin.
I've read it, too, at the library. I like some parts of it.
Why, Lily!
Good for you, Aunt Lily. Remember this part? A book of verses underneath the bough, a jug of wine, a loaf of bread, and thou beside me singing in the wilderness. Oh, wilderness!
Hey, look who's coming up the walk. Old man McComber.
Dave, what in thunder does that foolish old... Oh, Sid, I can see where we never are going to get to that picnic.
Nat, you get rid of him the first second you can. Whatever can the old fool want?
I'm going to beat it, too. Just time to catch the 820 trolley.
I've got to catch that, too.
Dick, McComber may be coming to see if your intentions toward his daughter are dishonorable.
Think I'm scared of him.
I only wish I didn't have to be pleasant with the old buzzard. And he's about the most valuable advertiser I've got.
I know, but tell him where to go anyway. He needs that ad more than you, Nat. Come on, Dick. We'll go out in the garden and help Tommy celebrate. Give it to him, Nat.
Here we are, Dave. Sit down. Make yourself comfortable. What good wind blows you around on this glorious fourth? Oh, have a cigar?
You're forgetting, Miller. I never smoke.
So I was. Well, I'll smoke alone, then.
Ask me what brings me here, so I'll come to the point at once. I regret to say it's something disagreeable. Disgraceful would be nearer the truth, and it concerns your son, Richard.
Oh, come now, Dave. I'm sure Richard hasn't done
and
anything.
And I'm positive he has. I brought some of the proofs with me. I've a lot of them at home, but these papers here are good samples of the rest. Wife discovered them in one of Muriel's bureau drawers, hidden under the underwear.
Well, let me see them.
They're all in his handwriting. You can't deny it. Anyway, Muriel's confessed to me he wrote them. Look at them.
Just a lot of poems, then.
Evidently, you've been too busy to take the right care about Richard's bringing up or what he's allowed to read. But I won't have Muriel's innocence exposed to the contamination of a young man whose mind, judging from his choice of reading matter, is as foul...
Why, you stupid old fool. Can't you see Richard's only a fool kid copying love poems? Here, listen to this one here. My life is bitter with thy love. Thine eyes blind, thy tresses burn me. Thy sharp sighs divide my flesh and spirit. Why, Dave, Richard's only a fool kid going through a stage. At heart, he's just as innocent and as big a kid as Muriel is. If you believe this stuff would corrupt Muriel, well, you must believe she's easily corrupted.
No, you're insulting my daughter. I won't forget that.
I'm not insulting her. I think Muriel's a darn nice girl. That's why I'm giving her credit for ordinary good sense.
Miller, I never dreamed you'd have the impudence, after reading those papers, to claim your son was innocent of all wrongdoing.
And what did you dream I'd do?
Give him a hiding he'll remember to the last day of his life. You'd ought to do it for his sake if you had any sense, unless you want him to end up in jail.
Now, Dave, I've stood all I can from you. You get out and get out quick if you don't want a helping kick from me.
You needn't lay hands on me. I'm going. But there's one thing more.
What's that?
Here's a letter from Muriel for your son. It makes clear, I think, how she's come to think about him. Now that her eyes have been opened, I hope he heeds what's inside for his own good and yours. And don't think I'm not going to make you regret the insults that you've heaped on me. I'm taking the advertisement from my store out of your paper for a while.
I'll tell you what I'm going to do, Dave. I'm going to refuse to print your rotten ad ever again. Put that in your pipe and smoke it. That's what I said to him, Sid, just like that.
Good for you, Nat. You sure gave it to him.
Not
much good it'll do.
Knows it was all talk.
Hallelujah! Imagine old David McComber's face when he saw that poetry stuff of Dick's.
But it's no joking matter, Sid, after all. The stuff is warm. It's no kind of thing to be sending a decent girl. I thought he was really stuck on her, all moonshine and holding hands and a kiss now and again, but... Well, these look... By George, maybe he deserves that licking McComber says it's my duty to give him. I've got to draw the line somewhere.
Yes, it won't do to have him getting into difficulties.
Well, the only thing I can do is put it to him straight. Richard will stand up to his guns no matter what. I've never known him to lie to me.
Then now's your chance. He's just outside in the garden with little Tommy. Now I'll beat it and leave you alone. We ought to get started soon if we're ever going to make that picnic.
Did you want to see me about something, Pa?
Look here, son. I'm going to ask you a question, and I want an honest answer. You've never lied to me before, I know, and I don't believe even to save yourself punishment that you'd lie to me now, would you?
I won't lie, Pa.
Richard, have you been up to anything, you know, anything you shouldn't have been up to with Muriel McComber?
Why, no, Pa. What do you think I am? Gosh, I'm in love with Muriel. I'm going to marry her after I get out of college. We're engaged.
All right. That's all I wanted to know. We won't talk any more about it.
I don't see how you could think of... Did that old idiot McComber say that about me?
Richard, look at these papers. Now, you can't exactly blame old Dave, can you?
Oh, he found those, did he? I told Muriel to be careful. Well, it'll do him good to read the truth about life.
I'm afraid I've got to agree with him, though, that they're hardly fit reading for a young girl. You think it over and see if you don't agree with me. Here's a letter from Muriel he said to give you.
A letter?
Yes, you better be prepared for a bit of a blow. But never mind, there's a lot of other fish in the sea.
Gee.
Well, I'd better go upstairs and get rigged out, or I never will get to that picnic.
Oh, how could she write these things? Oh, the little coward, I hate her. She can't treat me like this. I'll show her.
I want, Richard. You know, Sid couldn't tell us.
You can search me. Ask Pa.
Whatever's the matter with you, Richard? You sound as if you'd lost your last friend. What is it?
I don't feel so well. My stomach's sick.
You poor boy. What a shame. On the fourth, too, of all days.
Oh, darn Tommy and his darn firecrackers. You can't get any peace with that darn kid around. Darn the 4th of July anyway. I wish we still belonged to England.
How's the dinner getting along, Essie? Anything I can do?
Well, Nora's got the table set all wrong.
Oh.
But it isn't fair to ask you to help Lily on your vacation. You need your rest after teaching all year.
Oh, you know I love to help, Essie. Oh, I don't see how you and Nat stand me, having a cranky old maid sister around all the time.
What nonsense you talk. As if we weren't tickled to death to have you. What time's it getting to be?
6:15 by my watch.
I do hope those men folks aren't going to be late for dinner. But I suppose with that darn Sachem Club picnic, it's more likely than not.
Yes.
And, Lily, you mustn't mind if Sid comes home feeling a bit gay. I expect Nat to.
I don't think Sid will this time. Not after his promise.
I know, but men are weak. That was a good notion of Nat's getting Sid the job on the Waterbury Standard. He's making good money now. In a better position to get married than he ever was.
Well,
I hope he finds a woman who's willing. Though after he's through with his betting on horse races and dice, playing Kelly pool, there won't be much left for a wife. Lily, why don't you change your mind and marry Sid and reform him? You love him and always have.
Essie, I can't love a man who drinks.
You can't fool me. Lily, I know darn well you love him. And he loves you and always has.
Never enough to stop drinking for. It's 16 years since I broke off our engagement. But what made me break it off is as clear to me today as it was then.
Oh, he's a dumb fool, that's it. A stupid, dumb fool, that's what he is.
No, Essie. He's just Sid.
You're a good woman, Lily. Too good for the rest of us.
No, Essie.
Well, where's Richard, I wonder? He was brooding around here just a while ago.
He's out in the garden now, still brooding. He says he's all through with Muriel McCumber. It's all dead and past, he says.
Poor Richard.
Hello, Wint. Well, come on in.
Hey, keep it quiet, kid. I want the folks to know I'm here.
Look, tell Art I want to see him a second, will you? On the QT.
Can't. He's up at the Rands. Won't be home before 10 anyway.
Darn, I thought he'd be here for dinner. That gums up the works for a fare.
What is it, Wint? Can't I help?
Well, I might tell you. If you can keep your face shut.
Sure I can.
Well, I ran into a couple of swell girls from New Haven this aft, and I dated them up for tonight, thinking I could catch Art. Now it's too late to get anyone else, and I'll have to pass it up. I'm nearly broke, and I can't afford to blow them both to drinks.
I've got $11 saved up. I could loan you some.
Nix, kid. I don't want to borrow your money. But, say, have you got anything on for tonight?
No.
You want to come along with me? Now, I'm not trying to lead you astray, understand, but it'll be a help if you just sit around with Belle.
Belle?
Yeah, that's the other one. You know, feed her a few drinks. You don't have to do anything, not even take a glass of beer unless you want to.
Why shouldn't I?
Ever drink anything besides sodas?
Sure, lots of times. Lots of things.
I tell you straight, I wouldn't ask you to come if I wasn't in a hole. And if I didn't know you were coming down to Yale next year. I don't want to lead you astray.
Oh, I told you that was silly.
Well, see you later then. At the Pleasant Beach House at 9:30. I'm in the back door.
Is that the bar?
Yeah, that's it. See you later, Dick. 9:30.
All right. I'll show her she can't treat me the way she's done. I'll show them all.
Ma! Ma!
Yes, Tommy, dear.
Pa and Uncle Sid are coming. Gee, I'm glad. I'm awful hungry, Ma.
Yes, dear, I know. You always are.
Have we got lobsters, Ma?
Yes, we've got lobsters, Richard. You're looking better already. You are indeed. Oh, my Lily, there they are. I'm afraid. I'm afraid.
Yes, I might have known.
Ma? Ma, did you know about Uncle Sid? Listen, I'll whisper. Uncle Sid went to the stage.
Now, never mind, Mildred. You shouldn't notice such things at your age. And don't you encourage him by laughing at his foolishness, you hear?
You don't have to whisper, Mid. Think I don't know? Uncle Sid soused again.
Now, Tommy, you be quiet. Did I ever go to your place and sit right down and not another word out of you?
Come on.
Then you sit down, Richard and Mildred. Oh, you better too, Lily. We'll get him right in here and get some food in him. He'll be all right then.
All right, Essie. Here we are.
Nora? You can bring in the soup.
Sure, Mom. Here we are, Essie. Right on the dot. Here we are.
So I see. You're here. And if I didn't, you've told me 4 times already.
don't be critical, Essie. Don't be carpingly critical. Good news can stand repeating, can't it? Of course it can. Come on, Sid. Come in.
Good evening. Beautiful evening. I never remember seeing more beautiful sunset.
Oh, Sid.
Sorry. Sorry, Lily. Deeply sorry.
It's all right.
Nora, why, here's Nora.
Nat.
Nora, now, Mr. Miller, don't be making me laugh and getting me into trouble.
Nora?
Yes, ma'am. Here's the soup.
Ah-ha, sight for sore eyes. My beautiful Makushla, my starry-eyed Mavourneen.
Sure, Mr. Smith, it's you that have kissed the blarney stone.
That'll be all, thank you, Nora.
Yes, ma'am.
Sit down, you two.
Well, it's good to be home again.
Now then, what was I saying? Oh, sunsets, yes. Oh, why butt in? Hasn't sun perfect right to set? Mind your own business. And there you are. Am I right?
Right, Sid.
Right.
Mildred, sit up straight in your chair. You want to grow up a humpback? Richard, take your elbows off the table. Eat your soup now.
Soup?
Of course it's soup. What do you think it was, Sid?
Well, all right, then. Soup be it. Spoon? Is that any way to treat a fowl?
Now, Sid...
Down with spoons! We'll drink by hand. Oh, your good health, ladies. That was delicious lobster, Essie. Great. Tommy.
Yes, Uncle Sid?
Did you know your Uncle Sid is the man who invented lobster? In fact, one day when I was building the pyramids, it took a day off and just dashed off lobster.
Sid, now stop it.
Better slow down a little, Sid. Nobody will be able to digest those lobsters.
Sid better go right upstairs to bed for a while. That's what he better do.
Huh? Bed? Yes, maybe you're right, Essie. I am not at all well. I'll go immediately, if not sooner. Oh, but wait. There's still a duty I must perform. No day is complete without it. Lily, answer me once and for all. Will you marry me?
No, I won't. Never.
Right. Perhaps it's for the best. Too bad. So fine a woman once was Lily, and now such a slave to Ralph.
Sid, you leave Lily alone and go to bed.
Right. Good night, ladies. And again, we will meet.
Bye. Oh, I was trying so hard not to laugh. But you can't help it. He's so silly. But I suppose we really shouldn't. It only encourages him.
That's just it. You shouldn't. Even I laugh.
Lily. It does encourage him. That's been his downfall. Everyone always laughing. Everyone always saying what a card he is. What a case. What a caution.
So funny. And he's gone on. And we're all responsible, making it easy for him. We're all to blame. And all we do is laugh. Oh,
now, Lily, now, you mustn't take on so. It isn't as serious as all that.
Maybe it is to me. Or was once. I'm sorry, Ned. I'm sorry, Essie. I didn't mean to... I'm not feeling myself tonight. If you'll excuse me, I'll go in the front parlor and lie down on the sofa a while.
Of course, Lily. You do whatever you're a mind to.
I never knew Lily to come out with things that way before. Well, no use sitting here mourning over spilt milk. You kids go out in the yard and try to keep quiet for a while so as your Uncle Sid will get to sleep and your Aunt Lily can rest.
Ain't we going
to
set off the skyrockets and Roman candles, Paul?
Later, son, later. It isn't dark enough for them yet anyway.
Come on, Tommy. I'll see you kids quiet, Pa.
That's a good girl. Well, melancholy Dane, what are you doing?
I'm going out for a while. And you know what I think? It's Aunt Lily's fault Uncle Sid's going to ruin. It's all because he loves her and she keeps him dangling after her and ruins his life. Like all women love to ruin men's lives. I don't blame him for drinking himself to death. I'd do the same thing myself if I were in his boots.
Richard, you stop that talk.
Drink, for you know not whence you come nor why. Drink, for you know not why you're going or where.
Now listen here, young man. I've had about all I can stand of your nonsense for one day. You keep that talk to yourself, you hear me? Or you're going to regret it. Never mind now. I'm not fooling. Come along, Essie.
Richard, I'm ashamed of you. That's what I am.
Oh, Nat, tell me about
this. Oh, what do I care? I'm going to meet Wint and those girls and live like a free man. I'll show them.
You are listening to Studio One at CBS, presenting as its 12th broadcast in a feature series of hour-length dramas, Our Wilderness by Eugene O'Neill, arranged for radio by Fletcher Markle. The second portion will follow the customary pause for station identification. This is CBS, the Columbia. Continuing Columbia's full-hour feature production, Studio One. We present the concluding portion of Eugene O'Neill's comedy of the early 1900s, when life perhaps was a little simpler. Ah, Wilderness.
Ah, oh, come on, Sam, let's go.
No, thoroughly.
What's your name again?
Richard.
Well, drink up, why don't you, Richard? Your beard's getting flat.
I let it get that way on purpose. I like it better when it's flat.
You're a crazy kid, you are.
I wonder where Wint and your friend Edith got to.
They're probably still out on the beach, looking at the moon.
Uh-huh.
Say, George, is Bedelia the latest to hit this Hickberg? Why don't you get a new role for that old buck?
Complain to the boss, kiddo. I'm only the bartender.
Well, you'll catch up in time, I guess.
I could say the same for your young friend. I never seen such a spender. My head's dizzy bringing you drinks.
What's that?
Don't let him kid you, Richard. You show him. Loosen up and buy another drink. What's that?
Sure. Excuse me. I was thinking of something else. Have anything you like. See what the lady will have. And have one on me yourself.
Oh, that's talking. I'll take a cigar on you. What's yours, kiddo? The same?
The same, all right.
Yours, sir? Another beer?
A small one, please. I'm not thirsty.
Ah, don't be such a dead one. Have a man's drink.
Well?
Same as mine for him, George. And make his a real one, huh?
I get you. Something that'll warm him up.
My golly, if this isn't the deadest burg I ever struck. I bet they take the sidewalks in after 9 o'clock. Say, honestly, kid, does your mother know you're out?
Oh, cut it out. Why don't you try to kid me?
Well, you see, it's this way with me. I think you're one of the sweetest kids I've ever met. But you're so cold and indifferent.
I'm not cold and indifferent. It's only that I've got a weight on my mind.
All right, here. This'll be better.
You bet it will.
40 cents, that is, with a cigar.
Sure. Here's a dollar. Keep the change.
Yeah? Well, thank you, sir.
Don't mention it.
Hey, anybody here? How about some service?
Now,
come on. Yeah, I'm coming.
Golly, you're getting real generous, sweetie boy.
Why not? I'm no tightwad.
Well, here's how. Bottoms up.
Yeah, bottoms up.
That's something like. You feel better?
You bet.
Well, maybe you won't be so distant and unfriendly now, huh? Why don't you kiss me?
Sure.
Hey, you call that kissing? Here. What's the matter, sweetie boy? Haven't you ever kissed before?
Sure, lots of times. But I sworn off.
Sworn off kissing?
I took an oath I'd be faithful.
Till death do us part, huh? Who's the girl?
Never mind.
I'm not good enough to talk about her, I suppose.
I didn't mean that. You're all right.
So you're faithful to your one love, huh? And how about her? Bet she's out with a guy this very minute.
Don't say that. Don't you dare.
All right, have it your own way and be a sucker. Cut no ice with me.
Good evening. I hope I'm not butting in on your party, but my dogs are giving out standing at that bar.
That's all right with me. I've got no party on.
Well, that sounds helpful. Allow me to sit at the next table.
But I wouldn't do such, 'cause I loved her too much.
But I learned about women from her.
Let's have another drink.
You've had enough.
Oh, that's what you think.
Hey, what do you got there? A child poet or a child actor?
Well, no, it's got me guessing.
Well, if you're tired of cradle-robbing act, maybe we could get together and have a little fun, huh?
That's easy. I just pull my freight. Listen, kid.
Huh?
This is an old friend of mine, Mr. Smith from New Haven, just come in. I'm going over and sit at his table for a while, see? And you better go home.
I'm never going home. I'll show them.
Have it your own way. Only firmly.
Yet each man kills the thing he loves. By each, let this be heard.
Hey, this is rich. That's swell dope, young fella. Come on, give me some more, huh?
Some do it with a bitter look. Some with a flattering word. The coward does it with a kiss. The brave man with a sword. I did it with a kiss. I'm a coward.
Gee, he's copped a fine skinful. He's hardly had anything.
Then, at 10 o'clock, Eilert Loveborg will come. With vine leaves in his hair.
And bats in his belfry if he's you.
That's Ibsen.
Yeah, see, kid, this gal of yours don't appreciate poetry. She's lowbrow.
And you, I don't believe you ever knew her in New Haven at all. You just picked her up now. You leave her alone, you hear?
Oh, my golly, listen to
me. Hey, this is a scream. Here, let me try. Curse you, Jack Dalton. If I won't unhand her, what then?
I'll give you a good punch in the snoop, that's what.
Oh, say.
Help! Help!
Hey, cut out the noise. Up with
it. It's none of my business, brother, but if I were in your boots, I'd give this young souse the gate. He's underage.
He told me he was over 18.
I am.
Ah, I see what you mean. Come on now, kid, on your way. Start no trouble in here. Beat it.
I will not beat it.
Oh, won't you? Up, sir,
let go of me, you dirty coward.
Quiet now. I'll pin the Mary Ann on your jaw that'll quiet you. Out. Out you go.
What time is it now, Nat?
It's a little after 11.
Oh, I'm getting worried. Something dreadful. You don't know what might have happened to Richard. You read in the papers every day about boys getting run over by automobiles.
Oh, don't say that, Essie.
It's true, Lily.
Don't go imagining things now.
But why couldn't it happen with everyone that owns one out tonight? And a lot of those in no condition to drive? Why don't you go out and find him, Nat?
He'll be all right, Mother.
Essie, you mustn't worry so. You'll make yourself sick. Richard's all right. I've got a feeling in my bones he's all right.
I was going out to look if he wasn't back by 12 sharp. That'd be the time it'd take him to walk from the beach if he left after the last car. But I'll go now if it'll ease your mind. I'll take the auto and drive out the beach road. You better come with me, Sid.
Sure thing, Nat. Hey, there's someone on the porch now. That must be him.
Oh, thank heaven, thank heaven.
Darn him worrying us all like this.
Here he is.
Hello. Good evening. Hello.
Oh, what's happened to him? He's gone crazy. Richard.
Hello.
Crazy nothing. He's only soused.
You've got your nerve, you fresh kid. We'll take that out of you and we get you down to Yale.
Yesterday, this day's madness did prepare tomorrow's silence. Triumph for despair. Drink!
Richard, how dare
you! Don't you strike him, Nat. Don't you dare.
Steady, Nat. Keep your temper. No good bawling him out now. He don't know what he's doing.
Yeah. Guess you're right, Sid.
And then I will come with vine leaves in my hair.
Richard, you're intoxicated, you bad, wicked boy, you.
Ma. Ma, I feel rotten.
Richard.
You let me take care of him, Essie. I know this game backwards.
Oh, Richard.
Come on, old sport. Upstairs we go. Your old Uncle Sid will fix you up. He's the kid who wrote the book.
Darn it, Essie. I'd ought to be back at the office. I've got a whole pile of things that've got to be done today.
You don't mean to tell me you're going back without seeing him? Not after last night, Nat. It's your duty as a father.
Of course I'm not. I wish you'd stop jumping to conclusions. What else did I come home for, I'd like to know? Do I usually come way back here for dinner on a busy day? It's going on 2 o'clock. Where is Richard?
He's still in bed.
I made him stay in bed to punish him. And I thought he ought to anyway, after being so sick. But he says he feels all right. He ate all the dinner I sent up, Nora says.
I thought you weren't going to give him any dinner to punish him.
Well, in his weakened condition, I thought it best. I've kept reminding him his real punishment was still to come. That you were coming home to dinner on purpose. And then he'd learn that you could be terrible stern when he did such awful things.
Yes.
And that's just what it's your duty to do. Punish him good and hard. The idea of his daring... Oh, but you be careful how you go about it, Nat. Remember, he's like you inside, too sensitive for his own good.
Uh-huh.
And he never would have done it, I know, if it hadn't been for that darn little dunce Muriel and her numbskull father. And then all of us teasing him and hurting his feelings all day. And then you lost your temper and was so sharp with him right after dinner before he went out.
See, this is going to work round to where it's all my fault.
Now, I didn't say that, did I? Don't go losing your temper again.
Well, go and get him, Essie. It's late.
But he's still asleep now.
All right. I give up. I'm going back to the office. Bring a man all the way back here on a busy day, and then you... No consideration at all.
Oh, my.
Richard, what are you doing downstairs? Are you allowed up?
Of course I'm allowed up. Where's Mother?
She's gone up the street. How'd Pa punish you?
He didn't. He went back to the office without seeing me.
Well, you'll catch it later, and you ought to. You'd ever seen how awful you looked last night.
Oh, forget it, can't you, Mid?
Well, are you ever going to do it again? That's what I want to know.
What's that to you?
Well, if you don't solemnly swear you won't, then I won't give you something I've got for you.
All right, I promise. What is it?
A letter from Muriel. I was walking past her place just now when I saw her waving from their parlor window. And I went up and she said, give this to Dick. So I took it and here it is.
Thanks. Thanks, Miss. My dear sweetheart.
Gee, it must be nice to be in love like you are. All with one person.
Gee, Mid, do you know what she says?
What?
That she didn't mean a word in that other letter.
Huh?
Her old man made her write it. And she loves me and only me and always will, no matter how they punish her.
My, I never thought she had that much spunk.
And she's going to try and sneak out and meet me tonight at 9 o'clock. She says she thinks she can do it. Meet me at a little place we go to down at the beach.
But you're not allowed out, you silly, so you can't.
Can't I, though? You wait and see if I can. I'll sneak out and meet her tonight if it's the last thing I ever do, and I don't care how I'm punished after.
Goodness, I never thought you had such nerve.
The trouble with you is you don't understand what love means. Oh, hello there, Muriel. Is it 9 already?
Well, I thought you'd be waiting right here at the end of the path. I'll bet you'd forgotten I was even coming.
No, I hadn't forgotten, honest. But I got to thinking about life.
Well, you might think of me for a change. After all the risk I've run to see you.
Gosh, you're pretty tonight, Muriel. Seems ages since we've been together. You knew how I've suffered.
I did, too.
The despair in my soul. Something was dead in each of us, and what was dead was hope. Gosh, Muriel, it sure is wonderful to be with you again.
I'm glad it makes you happy. I'm happy, too.
Muriel, will you let me kiss you, please?
No, you mustn't. Don't.
Oh, why can't I?
Because I'm afraid.
Oh, that's what you always say. You're always so afraid. Aren't you ever going to let me?
I will, sometime.
When?
Soon, maybe.
Tonight, will you?
I'll see.
Promise?
I promise. Maybe.
All right, you remember, you promised. Gosh, Muriel, you don't realize what I've been through for you and what I'm in for sneaking out, but mostly for what I did last night. What your letter made me do.
What did my letter make you do?
It's a long story, and let the dead past bury its dead.
Tell me, Dick. Begin at the beginning and tell me.
Well, after I'd read it, I just didn't want to live anymore. Life seemed like a tragic farce. I thought your love for me was dead and I wanted to die. Finally, I made up my mind I'd kill myself.
Dick, you didn't.
I did, too. I thought, when I'm dead, she'll be sorry she ruined my life.
Oh, if you ever had, I'd have died, too. Honest, I would.
But suicide is the act of a coward. That's what stopped me. Anyway, I thought to myself, she isn't worth it.
Well, that's a nice thing to say.
So I said to myself, I'm through with women. They're all alike.
Well, I'm not.
And I thought, what difference does it make what I do now?
I might as well forget her and lead the pace that kills.
Oh.
After it was dark, I sneaked out and went to a low dive I know about.
Dick Miller, I don't believe you ever.
You asked them at the Pleasant Beach House if I didn't. They won't forget me in a hurry.
You went there? Well, that's a terrible place. Pa says it ought to be closed by the police.
I said it was a dive, didn't I?
Oh.
And they let me into a secret room behind the bar room. There wasn't anyone there but a Princeton senior I know. And he had two chorus girls from New York with him. And they were all drinking champagne.
Dick Miller.
One was named Belle. Oh. She had yellow hair, the kind that burns and stings you.
I'll bet it was dyed.
She kept smoking one cigarette after another. Oh. But that's nothing for a chorus girl.
And then what happened?
Oh, we just kept drinking champagne, and she said she'd fallen in love with me at first sight. Sat on my lap and kissed me.
Oh.
But it was only all in fun, and then we just kept on drinking champagne, and finally I said goodnight and came home.
And did you kiss her?
No, I didn't.
You did too, Richard Miller. You're lying, and you know it. Oh, I hate you. I wish you were dead. I'm going home this minute. I never want to lay eyes on you again. And this time I mean it.
Muriel, wait. Listen.
I don't want to listen. Let me go. If you don't, I'll bite your hand.
I won't let you go. You've got to let me explain. You did.
Okay.
All right. Go if you want to. You haven't the decency to let me explain. I hate you, too. I'll go and see Belle.
Well, go and see her. If that's the kind of a girl you like. What can you explain? You owned up, you kissed her.
I did not. I said she kissed me.
And I suppose you just sat there and let yourself be kissed. That sounds pretty fishy. Don't you know it does?
I don't know anything. I only know I wish I was dead.
Oh, you oughtn't to say that. It's wicked. And I suppose you'll tell me you didn't fall in love with her.
I should say not. Fall in love with that kind of girl? What do you take me for?
Well, how do you know what you did if you drank so much champagne?
I kept my head with her.
Then you really don't love her?
Muriel, I couldn't love her. I love you.
Well, then I still love you.
Then sit down again, why don't you?
All right. Only I'll have to go soon, Dick. I'm sorry I hurt your hand.
That was nothing. Felt wonderful even to have you bite.
Here, let me kiss it. That'll cure it.
You said you'd let me kiss you.
I said maybe.
Please, Muriel.
Will it wash off her kisses? Make you forget her? For always?
I should say so. I'd never remember anything else ever again.
Then, all right, Dick. The moon is beautiful, isn't it?
Not as beautiful as you are, Muriel. Nothing is. Won't it be wonderful when we're married?
Yes, but it's so long to wait.
Perhaps I needn't go to Yale. Perhaps Paul'll give me a job. Then I'd soon be making enough.
Well, you'd better do what your pa thinks best. And I'd like you to be at Yale. Poor you. Do you think he'll punish you awful?
I don't know, and I don't care. Oh, gosh, but I love you, darling.
And I love you, too, sweetheart. Where'll we go on our honeymoon, Dick? To Niagara Falls?
That dump where all the silly fools go? I should say not. No, we'll go to some far-off wonderful place. Somewhere out on the long trail. The trail that is always new on the road to Mandalay.
But I'm glad Mildred told me where Richard went off to. I'd have worried my heart out if she hadn't. But now it's all right.
I'd hardly go as far as to say that. He's still got to be punished, doesn't he?
Well,
If you ask me, I think after the way I punished him all day and the way I know he's punished himself, he's had about all he deserves. I have a lot of faith in our Richard.
Well, so have I, after all.
And as for his being in love with Muriel, I don't see but what it might work out real well. Richard could do worse.
But I thought you had no use for Muriel, thought she was stupid.
Well, so I did, but if she's good for Richard and he wants her... Ma used to say you weren't over bright, but she changed her mind when she saw I didn't care if you were or not.
Well, I've been bright enough to provide a home and...
Of course you have, dear. Did you say Sid and Lily had gone off too?
To the beach to listen to the band.
Poor Lily. Sid will never change. She'll never marry him.
Arthur's up with Elsie Rand, I suppose.
Of course.
Where's Mildred?
No, walking with her latest. I forgot who it is. I can't keep track of them.
Well, then, from all reports, we seem to be completely surrounded by love.
That'll be Richard.
Oh, yes. Well, I'll go out and meet him and talk to him on the porch. You stay here, Essie.
Of course, dear.
Let's sit down, Richard, eh?
All right, Pa.
Well, how are the vine leaves in your hair this evening?
I don't know, Pa.
Turned out to be poison ivy, didn't they? You needn't look so alarmed. I'm not going to read you any temperance lecture. That would bore me more than it would you. And in spite of your foolishness last night, I'm still giving you credit for having brains. So I'm pretty sure anything I could say to you, you've already said to yourself.
I know I was a darn fool.
You sure were. Not only a fool, but a downright stupid, disgusting fool.
I know, Pa.
Well, all right, then that settles that part of it. But there's one other thing. How about this girl at the Pleasant Beach House?
You know about that?
I do, and I want to know more about it.
Well, gosh, Pa, there wasn't anything in that. I just sat with her there for a while.
How did you happen to meet this lady, anyway?
I can't tell that, Pa. I'd have to snitch on someone, and you wouldn't want me to do that.
No, I suppose I wouldn't. Well, I believe you, and I guess that settles that. But, listen here, Richard. It's about time you and I had a serious talk about certain matters pertaining to... now that the subject has come up of its own accord, it's a good time. I mean, there's no use in procrastinating further, so... Here goes. Richard, you have now come to the age when, you're a man, almost, and it's only natural for you to have certain interests, pertaining to the opposite sex, certain natural feelings and temptations that will want to be gratified, and you'll want to gratify them. Well, human society being organized as it is, there's only one outlet for... unless you're a scoundrel, which you're not, of course. Well, there are a certain class of women that always have been and always will be, as long as human nature is what it is. It's wrong, maybe, but what can you do about it? I mean, girls like that one that you were with last night... Lots of them are pretty, and it's human nature, if you... But that doesn't mean to ever get mixed up with them seriously. Here's what I'm driving at, Richard. I mean your whole life might be ruined. I suppose you boys talk all this over among yourselves, and you know more about it than I do. I'll admit I'm no authority. I never had anything to do with such women, and it'll be a lot better for you if you never do.
I'm never going to, Pa. I don't see how you could think I could now when you know I love Muriel and I'm going to marry her. I'd die before
that's the talk. I'm proud of you when you talk like that. And now that's all of that. There's nothing more to say, and we'll forget it, hmm?
How are you going to punish me, Pa?
Oh, well, I was sort of forgetting that, wasn't I? Well, I thought of telling you that you couldn't go to Yale.
Don't I have to go? Gee, that's great. Muriel thought you'd want me to. I was telling her I'd rather you gave me a job in the paper because then she and I could get married sooner. Gee, Pa, you picked a lemon. This isn't any punishment. You'll have to do something besides that.
Well, then you'll go to Yale and you'll stay there till you graduate. That's the answer to that. Muriel's got good sense and you haven't.
Yes, Pa.
And now we're finished, you better call your mother.
Yes, Pa. Ma?
Yes, dear?
Come on out with us, Ma.
All right. My, it's a beautiful night, isn't it? Smells so good. Hello, Richard.
Hello, Ma.
Yeah, I don't believe I've hardly ever seen such a beautiful night with such a wonderful moon. Have you, Richard?
No, it was wonderful down at the beach.
Yes, I can only remember a few nights that were as beautiful as this. And they were long ago when your mother and I were young and planning to get married.
Yes, I'll bet those must have been wonderful nights, too. You sort of forget the moon was the same way back then. And everything?
You're a good boy, Richard.
Well, you better get to bed early tonight, son, hadn't you?
Oh, gee, I couldn't sleep. But I'll go up and read for a while.
All right, then you better say goodnight now.
Good night, Ma.
Good night. Don't you stay up reading till all hours now.
I won't. Good night, Pa.
Good night, Richard. You're all right, Richard.
Good night.
Well, I don't think we'll ever have to worry about his being safe from himself again. And I guess no matter what life will do to him, he can take care of it now. My darn feet are giving me fits.
Well, why are you bothering unlacing your shoes now, you big goose, when we're going right up to bed?
I guess you're right. Mind if I don't say my prayers tonight, Essie? Heaven knows I'm too darn tired.
Now, don't talk that way, Nat. It's real sinful. If that isn't you all over. Always looking for an excuse.
Now, Essie.
All right. I suppose tonight you needn't. You've had a hard day.
Did you notice how Richard looked tonight when he was talking about the moon? Like a statue of love's young dream. Mm-hmm. What's it that Rubaiyat says? Yet that spring should vanish with the rose, that youth's sweet-scented manuscript should close. Well, spring isn't everything, is it, Essie? There's a lot to be said for autumn. It's got beauty, too. And winter, if you're together.
Yes, ma'am.
Columbia Broadcasting System has brought you Studio One, the 12th program in a feature series of hour-length versions for listening of celebrated stories, novels, and plays. Tonight from Studio One, you have heard Fletcher Markle's production of Our Wilderness by Eugene O'Neill. The adaptation was prepared by Mr. Markle and the musical score conducted by Alexander Semler.
Now, may a producer identify the principals in our cast tonight. In the darkest part of the wilderness,
Richard Miller
was played by a very talented young Canadian actor named Don Harron, making his first appearance on Studio One and on the American air tonight. His father,
Nat Miller,
was played by Everett Sloan. His mother,
Essie Miller,
was Catherine Rott.
Lily
and Sid
were Jeanette Dowling and Robert Dryden.
Bill
was Ann Burr.
And Muriel McCumber
was played by Ruth Gilbert, who created the role in the original Broadway production of Our Wilderness. Next week from Studio One at CBS, a cool slice of summertime comedy. Our story is called Holiday. Philip Barry wrote it, and it's about a young man who believes in retiring while young and working in later years. Now until next week, until Holiday by Philip Barry, this is Fletcher Markle with a good night and thank you from all of us in Studio One.
This is CBS, the Columbia Broadcasting System.